بسم الله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أجمعين. إن شاء الله today we are going to talk about thyroid disorders in children. My name is Professor عبد المعين عيد الأغا, Faculty of Medicine, King Abdulaziz University, Jeddah. This presentation is available in my website www.aagha.kau.edu.sa. Objectives of this presentation: first of all, we are going to talk about hypothyroidism, recognize the anatomy and physiology of the thyroid gland, and how thyroid hormones are synthesized in the thyroid gland. And then we see the control of thyroid hormone production by the hypothalamic pituitary regulation. And then discuss various causes of primary, secondary, tertiary hypothyroidism, including congenital and acquired forms, clinical presentations of both congenital and acquired hypothyroidism, and lastly, to know some knowledge about the investigation and management of child with hypothyroidism. The second part of the presentation will be on the hyperthyroidism, and to ensure the and enumerate the various causes of thyrotoxicosis, including neonatal transient form of thyrotoxicosis, clinical presentation of thyrotoxicosis, and laboratory management of thyrotoxicosis. Start with thyroid gland. We come to thyroid gland, and everybody knows that thyroid gland embryologically derived from the floor of embryonic pharynx. It begins to develop around the age of 4 weeks, and the development continues till the age of 10 to 20 weeks of gestation. So that the fetal thyroid gland will not produce any thyroid hormones until 10 to 20 weeks of gestation. And during this period, the fetus depends on the mother thyroid gland. That's why every mother, pregnant mother, should be sure that her thyroid gland is functioning very well. And this is one of the important investigations during pregnancy for the mother to do her own thyroid function test to be sure that she doesn't have hypothyroidism, because the fetal thyroid will not function until 20 weeks of gestation. Thyroid gland size increases gradually by birth. The weight of the thyroid gland will be 1 gram, and then the weight of the thyroid gland will increase 1 gram per year till the maximum adult size 15 to 25 gram. Here the diagram showing that the sites where the thyroid gland descends from the base of the tongue, embryonic pharynx, into the normal position. If there is any maldescent means that the thyroid gland does not go to the actual place Allah make it for it. So for example, if descends here or here or retrosternal, it will not function very well. And that is one of the causes of congenital hypothyroidism, what is called ectopic thyroid gland. Ectopic thyroid gland means the thyroid gland did not reach to the actual site Allah make it for it. Thyroid gland composed of million of follicles. If you can see the diagram, histologically, if we do a cross section of the thyroid gland, will be millions of follicle. The follicle is the main unit of the thyroid gland. Follicle structure, the outside is capsule, and as you can see, the capsule is surrounded by a lot of blood vessels. That's why thyroid gland considered to be a vascular organ. Too many blood vessels around each follicle. And then after the capsule, there will be epithelial cells. And inside the epithelial cells, there is something called trapping mechanism, where the thyroid epithelial cells traps any iodine molecule from the circulation, and after it traps, send it to a colloid. And this is the big space of the follicle is colloid. The colloid is considered to be the storage place for the thyroid gland, as well as the synthesis place of the thyroid gland, i.e. the iodine, when it trapped from the circulation by epithelial cells and then to be sent to the colloid, iodine will bind to tyrosine molecule inside the thyroglobulin, and the process of synthesis of T4, T3 starts in the colloid. And the excess amount of iodine not used for the synthesis of T4, T3 will be stored in the colloid as well. So colloid is a storage place and synthesis place for the thyroid hormones. Thyroid gland normally secretes T4. So the main place of synthesis of T4 is thyroid gland only. While T3, 70% of T3 produced from the peripheral tissue, conversion of T4 into T3 by the enzyme called 5-deiodinase enzyme. And 30% of T3 produced from the thyroid gland. Both T4 and T3 are bound in the circulation, bound by thyroid binding globulin, prealbumin, and albumin. Only 0.025% of T4 and 0.35% of T3 are in free form. That's why for us as a doctor, as endocrinologist, when we evaluate the thyroid function test, it's better to screen for free T4, to test for free T4 and free T3 rather than total T4 and total T3, because if we measure total T4 or total T3, other factors are involved. For example, if the child has low albumin or child has low TPG, the total form will be low. Not because hypothyroidism, because of the binding protein is low. So it's very important to do the free T4 and free T3 rather than total T4 and total T3. T4 production in children is much, much more than T4 production in adult. Why? Because the basal metabolic rate in childhood is much higher than adulthood. So T4 or thyroxine is very important for basal metabolic rate. That's why the production in children per kilogram is higher than the production of T4 per kilogram in adult. And the dose per kilogram of thyroxine in children, when we treat hypothyroidism in children, they require higher dose per kg of thyroxine, more than adult dose per kg, because in adulthood there is no much need of thyroxine as in childhood. The regulation and the control of the thyroid hormone production of T4 and T3, first of all, from the hypothalamus. Hypothalamus produces a hormone called TRH. TRH is thyrotropin-releasing hormone. Thyrotropin is the other name of TSH. So thyrotropin-releasing hormone, that means like TSH-releasing hormone. Thyrotropin-releasing hormone stimulates the anterior pituitary gland to produce TSH. TSH from the anterior pituitary gland stimulates the thyroid follicle to synthesize 100% of T4 and 30% of T3, and in the peripheral tissue, T4 will be converted into T3. The thyroid hormone synthesis, what's written in the slides, I will explain it in this paragraph. First of all, for the thyroid hormone synthesis, all depends on iodine. All depends on iodine. So if somebody has iodine deficiency, in some countries of the world, they are endemic for iodine deficiency. That's why common for them to have what is called endemic hypothyroidism or endemic goiter. But luckily in Saudi Arabia, we don't have iodine deficiency because, alhamdulillah, iodine is added to the salt. So whenever we eat a salt, it is iodinated salt, so there is no risk for Saudi community or those living in Saudi Arabia to have iodine deficiency, because our salt is iodinated, and those with hypothyroidism, there is no need for them to eat seafood, more seafood, because as you know, seafood is rich of iodine, and some of the doctors ask them to eat more seafood because rich of iodine. No need in Saudi Arabia because it's already present in iodine, in the salt. So first step depends on iodine. In the circulation, iodine is present in iodide form. And then, as I mentioned, in the epithelial cells, there is a trapping mechanism called NIS, sodium iodide disulfide, will trap all iodide molecules from the circulation and get it inside the colloid. The colloid, can you see, it is the place where all the process of thyroid hormone synthesis happens inside the colloid. And the first step of the synthesis, when iodine combined with tyrosine amino acid, tyrosine amino acid is present inside the thyroglobulin. So thyroglobulin contains tyrosine, one molecule of iodine with one molecule with tyrosine will produce monoiodotyrosine. Two molecules of iodine with two molecules with tyrosine produce diiodotyrosine. This step and other steps important to have one enzyme called thyroid peroxidase. So we have to memorize two names. We have to memorize thyroglobulin molecule because it contains tyrosine amino acid, and we have to memorize thyroid peroxidase enzyme because the whole process of thyroid hormone synthesis depends on this enzyme. The second step or the third step of the synthesis of thyroid hormones is called coupling. Coupling, when monoiodotyrosine combined with diiodotyrosine bring to triiodothyronine, which is T3, or diiodotyrosine with diiodotyrosine produce T4. So T4 and T3 produced by process of called coupling process. And when we have T3, T4, it release into the circulation by the process called endocytosis. Endocytosis depends on TSH. So TSH is controlling the synthesis as well as controlling the release of T4 and T3 into the circulation. Depends on the need of the body to T4 and T3. And when the T4, T3 is released into the circulation, immediately it binds, majority of them binds to, as I mentioned, prealbumin, albumin, and thyroid binding globulin. Let's see the effects of thyroid hormones on the body. Number one effect, the most important effect of thyroid hormones on the body is on the brain. And the brain, whether intrauterine or after birth, till the age of 5 years, is highly dependent on thyroxine. That's why children with congenital hypothyroidism, if not diagnosed early after birth, they will suffer from mental retardation or with decreased IQ. That's why, alhamdulillah, in Saudi Arabia, there is thyroid screening unit, screening for congenital hypothyroidism, which is the most important thing to minimize the risk of mental retardation or low IQ among children with congenital hypothyroidism. The effect of thyroid hormones on the brain development continue up to the age of 5 years. After age of 5 years, if there is hypothyroidism, for example, in acquired form of hypothyroidism, there is no risk of mental retardation or decreased IQ. The risk is before age of 5 years, if not treated. If treated, nothing will happen to the brain. The brain development will be completely normal. But the problem, if late diagnosis of congenital hypothyroidism, they will suffer from, the children, affected children will suffer from mental retardation or low IQ. The second most important effect of thyroid hormones on the skeleton and skeletal maturation from intrauterine life up to age of puberty. That's why hypothyroidism is one of the causes of short stature. Very important to diagnose hypothyroidism early to prevent short stature, whether congenital form or acquired form. But the congenital form, because it's discovered early, treated early, there is no risk to produce short stature. The acquired form is the main reason of short stature. The third function of thyroid hormone is increase in basal metabolic rate. That's why in children with hypothyroidism, they will suffer from decrease basal metabolic rate. That's why they are getting fat and fat, because their metabolism is slow. They don't lose a lot of calories. That's why they are getting weight. The opposite in hyperthyroidism, when we have high basal metabolic rate, these children, affected children, will lose a lot of calories because of high metabolism. That's why one of the symptoms of hyperthyroidism is weight loss, and one of the symptoms of hypothyroidism is weight gain. The fourth effect of the thyroid hormones on the heart, affecting both contractility and the rate. In hypothyroidism, we have bradycardia and low output heart failure, congestive heart failure. And the congestive heart failure in hypothyroidism, untreated hypothyroidism, is producing generalized body edema. But the main characteristic of generalized body edema of hypothyroidism is non-beating edema, opposite to all other causes of heart failure. Other causes of heart failure produces beating generalized edema. Mixed edema of hypothyroidism is non-beating edema. In hyperthyroidism, the heart rate is high, so tachycardia, arrhythmia is major manifestation of hyperthyroidism, as well as hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis. If not treated, the child will have high output heart failure. Opposite to hypothyroidism, low output heart failure, here high output heart failure, hyperdynamic circulation, and hyperdynamic circulation is the reason where when we listen to the heart of the child with thyrotoxicosis, we might hear a murmur, overflow murmur, or functional murmur because of hyperdynamic circulation. The next effect of thyroid hormones is increased sensitivity to catecholamine. Those with hypothyroidism, the sensitivity is low. That's why they are lazy. They are like slow motion. They don't move a lot because the sensitivity to catecholamine is low. While the opposite seen in hyperthyroidism, where they have high sensitivity to catecholamine, so these children, they are having, they are always jittery, irritable, always sweating, all flushed face because of increased sensitivity to catecholamine. Another important effect of thyroid hormones on the gut. In hypothyroidism, the gut motion or bowel movement is low. That's why they have constipation. In hyperthyroidism, the bowel movement is high. That's why they have diarrhea. Increased bone turnover in thyrotoxicosis is one of the major factors of osteoporosis. And thyroid hormone play a role in serum glucose. Those children with hypothyroidism, they might suffer from hypoglycemia. Children with thyrotoxicosis, they might have what is called secondary diabetes. Secondary diabetes because high thyroxine will make high blood sugar, and that's why they might have secondary diabetes. The opposite seen in cholesterol, those with thyrotoxicosis, they have low lipid. Those with hypothyroidism, they have secondary dyslipidemia, one of the major consequences of hypothyroidism is secondary hyperlipidemia. Thyroid hormone is also important for conversion of carotene to vitamin A. If we have hypothyroidism, the conversion is slow, and that's why they have yellow skin. One of the manifestations of hypothyroidism is yellow skin because of accumulation of carotene in the skin. Why accumulated? Because the conversion is not complete of carotene into vitamin A. And the last but not the least important function of the thyroid hormone in the thermal regulation, those with children with hypothyroidism, they have cold intolerance, and children with hyperthyroidism, they have heat intolerance. Now we come to the causes of hypothyroidism. Hypothyroidism could be congenital hypothyroidism, so from birth up to age of 3 to 5 years, or acquired usually after 3 to 5 years of age. If hypothyroidism happens after 3 to 5 years of age, that is acquired. If it happens from birth up to 3 to 5 years of age, it is congenital. So we have congenital hypothyroidism or acquired hypothyroidism. And in each one, in each type, it might be primary. Primary means the problem in the thyroid gland itself. Secondary, the problem from the TSH production from pituitary gland. Tertiary, the problem from the hypothalamus. So if you have a hypothalamus defect, that is tertiary. Pituitary defect secondary, thyroid gland defect is primary. Whether it is since birth or acquired can be primary, secondary, or tertiary. We start with congenital hypothyroidism, and the main cause of congenital hypothyroidism, what is called thyroid dysgenesis. Thyroid dysgenesis, that means there is a defect in the thyroid gland development embryologically. Either the defect is complete absence of thyroid gland called athyrosis, happens in 40% of cases of congenital hypothyroidism, or the thyroid gland was formed but not complete formation or genesis that cause hypoplasia in 40% of cases. And sometimes the thyroid gland size is normal, but unfortunately there was maldescent from the embryonic pharynx, base of the tank, into the usual actual place, what is called ectopic thyroid gland, because of maldescent, and that happens in 20% of cases. All the three categories, athyrosis, hypoplasia, ectopic, under the terminology of thyroid dysgenesis, which is the commonest cause in 95% of cases with congenital hypothyroidism. Sometimes there is a rare cause of congenital hypothyroidism if we have a defect in the process of thyroid hormone synthesis, as was seen in the previous slide, when the thyroid hormone synthesis T4 or T3, there is a defect by any reason. Autosomal recessive disorder happens in 10% of cases. Sometimes we don't have a congenital primary hypothyroidism. Sometimes we have a congenital secondary or congenital tertiary because of either congenital pituitary problem or congenital hypothalamic problem. And the commonest cause of all these, if we have a congenital brain malformation. For example, if the child is having some what is called anencephaly, or a child is having holoprosencephaly or septo-optic dysplasia, the whole brain is malformed. And as you know, pituitary and hypothalamus is inside the brain. When we have neuronal malformation or brain malformation, most likely also will have pituitary and hypothalamic malformation producing secondary or tertiary congenital hypothyroidism. And this is just a slide showing some of the features of congenital hypothyroidism. The baby usually will not have this manifestation at birth because at birth the thyroxine comes to the baby from the placenta, and this manifestation happens usually after 7 to 14 days of birth, when thyroxine level from the mother disappear and the child cannot have his own thyroxine production. That's why this presentation is not from birth. And that's why there is neonatal screening for congenital hypothyroidism. If this baby is born with this manifestation, no point of doing hypothyroidism screening for all babies born. Manifestation comes later on. As you can see, that yellow skin, and sometimes we have yellow sclera. If there is yellow skin and yellow sclera, that is prolonged neonatal jaundice. One manifestation of congenital hypothyroidism is prolonged neonatal hyperbilirubinemia, or only yellow skin without yellow sclera, and also that is a manifestation of hypothyroidism. We might have abdominal distension because of weak abdominal muscles. We might have umbilical hernia. We might have hypotonia. If you can see the face, it is coarse faces, and if you can see the tongue, it is protruded tongue. The hair is silky, and you can see there is some sort of hair loss, brittle hair, all these manifestation of hypothyroidism. If hypothyroidism congenital not treated, the child will be very short, and will be mentally retarded. If we have a mental retardation because of congenital hypothyroidism untreated, that is called cretinism. Cretinism only for those children with congenital hypothyroidism not treated with thyroxine became to have mental retarded. This is a slide, very important to see the ectopic thyroid gland at the base of the tongue, what is called the lingual thyroid. This is a lingual thyroid. This is not the tonsils, this is the thyroid gland itself. And the ectopic hypothyroidism is one of the causes of congenital primary hypothyroidism. This is a slide showing congenital, secondary, and tertiary hypothyroidism. As you can see, there is a midline facial defect. There is cleft lip, cleft palate, depressed nasal bridge, hypotularism. These are manifestation of midline facial defect. And this child is affected with central hypothyroidism, central congenital hypothyroidism. Central means from pituitary and from the hypothalamus defect. Or the child might have isolated cleft lip or isolated cleft palate. Isolated cleft lip and palate is associated with central hypothyroidism. What are the manifestations of congenital hypothyroidism? Number one, big tongue, large tongue, what is called macroglossia. Prolonged neonatal hyperbilirubinemia, poor feeding, hoarse cry, decreased activity, constipation, umbilical hernia, dry yellow skin, large anterior fontanelle, and sometimes delayed closure of anterior fontanelle if not diagnosed early. So either the anterior fontanelle is large or delayed closure, and the skeletal maturation is delayed in congenital hypothyroidism. Alhamdulillah, in Saudi Arabia, as well as most of the world countries worldwide, they have neonatal screening for congenital hypothyroidism by doing, in Saudi Arabia, by doing TSH screening. From the cord blood in Saudi Arabia, different from other countries in the world where they do filter paper screening of TSH by 2 to 3 days of life. In Saudi Arabia, it's done from the congenital, from the cord blood at birth. Now when we come to acquired hypothyroidism, the commonest cause of acquired hypothyroidism is Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Hashimoto's is the autoimmune destruction of the thyroid gland, first described by Hashimoto doctor, described the first cases of Hashimoto thyroiditis. And the main reason is because present of two antibodies. Number one, total antibody against thyroid peroxidase antibody called TPO antibody, and the other antibody called TG antibody, thyroglobulin antibody. TBO antibody present in 90% of cases of Hashimoto thyroiditis. TG thyroglobulin antibody present in 50 to 60% in cases of acquired hypothyroidism. Acquired hypothyroidism could be also from other reasons, but the commonest cause is Hashimoto. Could be from iatrogenic radioactive iodine therapy, could be from iodine deficiency, but as you can see in the slide, not in Saudi Arabia, as iodine is added to table salt. So iodine deficiency is not a cause in Saudi Arabia of acquired hypothyroidism, but still in some countries of the world, still is considered to be one of the main factors, causes of acquired hypothyroidism. Sometimes medication-related hypothyroidism, especially amiodarone in the treatment of cardiac arrhythmia. Sometimes the hypothyroidism is transient. Why transient? Mostly due to infection, whether it's viral infection, subacute thyroiditis, or bacterial infection, suppurative acute thyroiditis. Both of them usually is causing transient form of hypothyroidism, and when the infection resolves, the thyroid function becomes normal again. if we look into the manifestation of acquired hypothyroidism, there are a lot of similarity of manifestation of acquired hypothyroidism with the congenital hypothyroidism. For example, there will be a cold intolerance, depression, weight gain, hoarseness of the voice, dry skin, constipation, general malaise, arthralgia, myalgia, brittle hair, menstrual irregularity. There are a lot of similarity. But of course, in acquired hypothyroidism, there is no umbilical hernia. In acquired hypothyroidism, there is no prolonged jaundice, but there is dry skin, dry yellow skin, but there is no prolonged jaundice. In acquired hypothyroidism, there is no mental retardation. So mental retardation is not a feature of acquired hypothyroidism. Hypotonia is not a feature of acquired hypothyroidism. So in acquired hypothyroidism, different from congenital hypothyroidism by few symptoms, but majority of symptoms are overlapped between all of them. Umbilical hernia, jaundice, mental retardation, hypotonia, not a feature of, and coarse features, not a feature of acquired hypothyroidism. On the examination, a child with acquired hypothyroidism could have dry, pale, coarse skin with yellowish tinge, yellow skin, periorbital edema, could have puffy face and extremities, non-beating edema, sinus bradycardia, hypothermia, delayed relaxation of reflexes, especially ankle reflex, megacolon, pericardial blue refusion, congestive heart failure, non-beating edema, between two bracket mixed edema, hoarse voice, proximal myopathy. Goiter can be a manifestation of hypothyroidism. Goiter can be a manifestation of hyperthyroidism. Goiter could be a manifestation of a normal person, especially during puberty, what is called physiological pubertal goiter, or hypothyroid goiter, or hyperthyroid goiter. So goiter is not a specific sign. It can happen in hypothyroidism, it could happen in hyperthyroidism, it could happen in euthyroid person. Short stature, one of the manifestations of hypothyroidism. So acquired hypothyroidism child might present only with short stature. So not important to have, very important to notice that not only a child with hypothyroidism acquired should come with constipation, all the manifestations we have mentioned, he or she might comes only with short stature. That's why it's mandatory any child with short stature to do thyroid function test. How to diagnose? In congenital hypothyroidism, we have to do TSH level. We have to do free T4 and free T3, as well as thyroid isotope scan. Why a thyroid isotope scan? To detect the reason of congenital hypothyroidism. Is it complete absence of thyroid gland? Is it hypoplasia? Is it ectopic thyroid gland? While in acquired hypothyroidism, the same, we'll do DSH, we'll do free T4, free T3. We add here thyroid antibodies. Why? Because we said Hashimoto's thyroiditis is the commonest cause of acquired hypothyroidism. That's why we need to do thyroid antibodies. As mentioned before, we have to do two antibody. One is called anti-TBO, thyroid peroxidase enzyme, anti-TG, thyroglobulin antibody. And because of goiter, we need to do thyroid ultrasound. Treatment of choice, whether we have a congenital hypothyroidism or acquired hypothyroidism, the main treatment is thyroxine. L-thyroxine is the drug of choice. L-thyroxine, very important to be taken early morning on empty stomach. On empty stomach, and not to have food after taking thyroxine at least 30 to 60 minutes in order to allow free absorption of thyroxine. Now we come to the opposite disease, which is hyperthyroidism or thyrotoxicosis. And thyrotoxicosis in children is not as common as hypothyroidism in children. So hypothyroidism much, much more common in children than thyrotoxicosis. It can be thyrotoxicosis can have many causes. The commonest is Graves' disease. Graves' disease is an American doctor described the first cases of thyrotoxicosis in year 1835. Described this disease, and the main reason of Graves' disease, also autoimmune disease, in addition to the two antibodies we talk about it, anti-TBO and TG, there's very important test for Graves' disease, which is TSH receptor antibody. TSH receptor antibody, which is what is called TSI or TRAP. TRAP, TSH receptor antibody, that this antibody stimulates the receptor of the thyroid gland, works as TSH, so the thyroid gland produces too much thyroxine and T3 because a similarity between this antibody and TSH. Or could be the thyrotoxicosis could be due to toxic multinodular goiter, could be due to toxic solitary adenoma, or central TSH producing adenoma, what is called TSHoma. This is a manifestation of a mother with Graves' disease. And this is her baby born with thyrotoxicosis. But the baby will not have a persistent thyrotoxicosis or permanent thyrotoxicosis. Will have what is called transient neonatal thyrotoxicosis because the antibody, TSH receptor antibody, IgG antibody transferred to the baby through the placenta, producing proptosis, tachycardia, all the manifestation of neonatal thyrotoxicosis. But only for 6 to 12 weeks, this is the half-life for IgG. After 6 to 12 weeks, there will be no more thyrotoxicosis. Of course, during this 6 week to 12 weeks from birth, we have to treat the child, otherwise the child might die from heart failure or arrhythmia. So treatment is a must, but the duration of treatment for transient neonatal thyrotoxicosis, usually 6 to 12 weeks, while the treatment of Graves' disease, most of the cases will be for long period of treatment because it is a persistent disease. Graves' disease is autoimmune disease. It is T-cell dependent autoimmune disease, have some HLA association with HLA A1, B8, DR3, DR4, DR5. If you can remember DR3 and D4, these HLA, DR3, DR4, they are present in diabetes. So sometimes children with type 1 diabetes, they have Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Sometimes children with type 1 diabetes, they have Graves' disease because common association of certain HLA between the two diseases. The antibodies present in Graves' disease, as mentioned earlier, TSH receptor antibody, two abbreviation, either TRAP or TSI, the same abbreviation for thyroid TSH receptor antibody. Could be thyroglobulin autoantibody, could be thyroid peroxidase autoantibody. The clinical manifestation of thyrotoxicosis is completely opposite to clinical manifestation of hypothyroidism. For example, here the child is jittery, shaky, nervous, and hypothyroidism will be the opposite. Child will be lazy, sleepy, very quiet person. Here, difficulty in concentration, emotional ability, insomnia. Children and adults with hyperthyroidism, they don't have sleep, normal sleep. Opposite to hypothyroidism, they can sleep the whole day and the whole night. Always they have sleepiness. In hyperthyroidism, they don't sleep, so they're completely opposite. Here, in thyrotoxicosis, tachycardia, palpitation, and hypothyroidism, bradycardia. Here, always feeling hot, and hypothyroidism, always feeling cold. Weight loss and hyperthyroidism, weight gain and hypothyroidism, diarrhea and hyper, constipation, hypo, fatigue in both diseases, they are feeling fatigue, and the menses in hyperthyroidism is light flow and short duration, opposite to menses of hypothyroidism, excessive, heavy, long duration of period. The signs of hyperthyroidism, the most important sign is eye diseases. Eye symptoms, especially proptosis, might have goiter, might have thyroid brewy because hyperdynamic circulation, tachycardia, atrial fibrillation, flow murmur because of hyperdynamic circulation, systolic hypertension, hyperreflexia, tremor, proximal muscle weakness, clubbing, onycholysis, and dermopathy. And this slide summarizes some of the eye findings of the child with thyrotoxicosis, lid lag and lid retraction. And if you can see the look of this lady, what is called staring look, staring look. This is the dermopathy, what is called pre-tibial myxedema. Pre-tibial myxedema only in front of tibia, opposite to hypothyroidism when they have generalized myxedema. So in hypothyroidism, generalized myxedema, and thyrotoxicosis, only myxedema, non-betting edema over the tibia, what is called pre-tibia myxedema, caused by dermis infiltration by lymphocyte. Clubbing is a manifestation of thyrotoxicosis, not of hypothyroidism. Thyrotoxicosis producing clubbing because of increased blood flow to the nails, making clubbing, hyperdynamic circulation, tremor of the hand as well. To diagnose thyrotoxicosis, we have to do TSH, and TSH will be very low, very suppressed. T4 and T3 will be high, and we have to confirm by doing measurement of antibody, especially the most specific antibody, we have to do thyroid receptor antibody. Isotope scanning is very important in evaluating any child or adult with thyrotoxicosis. This is isotope scan of the thyroid gland in a normal person. As you can see, normal uptake of the iodine isotope thyroid scan. Here in a child with Graves' disease or adult with a huge excessive uptake of the iodine, radioactive iodine. Here, patchy uptake in cases of toxic multinodular goiter. Here, isolated uptake, high uptake in toxic adenoma. And children with acute and subacute thyroiditis presented with thyrotoxicosis as transient thyrotoxicosis, when we do isotope scanning, there will be no uptake because of the infection. Treatment modalities of thyrotoxicosis, we have one of the three options. We have either antithyroid medication, antithyroid therapy as initial treatment. Second line of treatment is radioactive iodine, and we have to use it in children above 10 years of age. We cannot use it below 10 years of age. And the third option is surgical near total or subtotal thyroidectomy is the last option for children and adults with thyrotoxicosis. Regarding the antithyroid medication, the commonest two group of medication we have available all over the world for thyrotoxicosis, number one is methimazole, and number two is probiothyroxine. Probiothyroxine is not a first option or as antithyroid because of liver toxicity. And many years ago, there were two fatalities, two deaths from probiothyroxine because of acute fulminant hepatitis. That's why the recommendation not to use probiothyroxine unless we have allergy to methimazole or pregnant woman in first trimester, and sometimes lactating women, they could use probiothyroxine because the secretion in the milk and teratogenicity of probiothyroxine is less than methimazole. Apart from these three indications, methimazole is a drug of choice of antithyroid gland. Side effect is very important to recognize side effect of antithyroid hormones. We have rash, arthralgia, nausea, vasculitis, a liver function disturbance, liver enzyme, especially with BTU, agranulocytosis. Agranulocytosis is one of the serious side effects of antithyroid hormones, whether from methimazole or probiothyroxine. We have to monitor CBC always and white blood cells always. And last but not least, side effect and viriopathy, both of them affect the fetus if the mother taking antithyroid, but probiothyroxine is less teratogenic than methimazole. Beta blocker is very important to combine with antithyroid to reduce the tachycardia and the nervousness, and tremor, jitteriness of the child or adult with thyrotoxicosis, the drug of choice is atenolol, but propranolol could be used as well. Radioactive iodine in children is a second line, and it's very effective, very easy, especially above age of 10 years of age, and it's safe to be used. Lastly, but not the least option, is surgery, subtotal thyroidectomy. But the problem of subtotal thyroidectomy could have been permanent hypoparathyroidism, recurrent laryngeal nerve palsy, bleeding, because thyroid gland is very highly vascular, so could have bleeding and loss of blood. But luckily, this complication is usually very little if we have very experienced surgeon doing thyroid gland surgery. Finally, I end my presentation hoping all the best for all audience. موفقين بإذن الله.